Going.
It should record now.
There we go. Great. Okay. So, this is always a little different every time I do it. I've sometimes taught a class like this, like every day for a week. Last summer I did a one-off version of it on Zoom for Amherst Early Music, and it worked really well. And it's what's my couple of disclaimers. Everybody has their own different approach and their own special ways of conceptualizing vial technique. And so I don't give you this as gospel or as you have to do it this way. I just think it's very interesting and very effective. And my own approach has changed a lot over the years, from thinking a lot about arm and arm weight to thinking much more about hand and fingertips as the motivating or the focal point of the whole thing. But on the other hand, your fingers aren't going to work unless all of you is present and involved and available. So I start off with some more whole body kind of approach to it. And so I have a catchphrase from whole body engagement to fingertip control to encapsulate this kind of little body of work that we're going to do. And anything that I tell you to do is an invitation and not an instruction. So, you're welcome to try everything. I do recommend it, but absolutely don't transgress any of your own physical limitations. Don't do anything that feels uncomfortable or exhausting. If I tell you stand up, sit down. Okay, now stand up again. And I like to do that a few times. Don't let me exhaust you. Don't do your knees in. But let's all stand up. I haven't picked up my vial or bow yet. So that doesn't matter if you're holding it, you can put it down. And I'm sorry, my head is cut off. Perhaps I'll move back a little bit. Trusting you can still hear me all right. But keeping my chair there. How about sit down? This is like if you've ever done any Alexander technique, standing and sitting is kind of a basic thing. So when we sit, we're on the edge of the chair, of course, and our feet are flat on the floor. If you just lean forward and let the weight of your head help you stand up and jiggle around, and you jiggle your knees and let your knees jiggle your hips a little bit. Jiggle your hands, let your hand jiggle your shoulders, and take a breath in and sit down. And I do seriously, the title of this workshop is like daily warm-ups. So I sincerely suggest doing this before you sit down to practice, or maybe even play as a group. And now I'm going to suggest, before we even pick up the vial, let's pick up the bow. So anybody who has a bow there, just hold it any old way for a minute. And I guess down near the frog where you normally hold it. And just feel the weight of that stick, the stick and the frog, and how does it feel different? Holding it vertically like that, or vertically the other way, or how does it travel like that? Does it get a. Do you feel as though you're about to drop it? And you can even, actually, I'm gonna come close and show you my bow hold. And again, there are different bow holds that people use, different ones that are maybe more historically fitted to different times and places. But this is the one that to me gives the most flexibility. So it's the one I use for everything. And there are two parts of it. This is probably familiar territory, but maybe you haven't thought of it quite like this. There's the stick, and you have your thumb and index finger on the stick, just opposite the second knuckle of your index finger, and then the thumb curving around. And you want a reasonably firm, that's like your pivot point. Needs to be a little anchor there. And then on the hair, you have your middle finger that just hooks over it and kind of hangs on it. And with a completely different job to do is the ring finger, which, well, now it's harder to see because I let my wrist hang so that the bow and hair is kind of horizontal like that. And the ring finger is supporting the tip. So the tip is supported. That's another like pivot point. And that's really important for being comfortable off the string as well as on the string. Now try again with the, you could just let the bow hang like that and see if you can make a little circle with the tip. And just feel what your fingers are doing in order to make that happen. This is one I just invented on the spot. I've never done that before. And then see if you can do the same thing horizontally. Make a little circle with the tip. And maybe even a little figure of eight with the tip. And see what your fingers are doing in order to do that. Everybody with me? Comfortable? So we're maybe still standing. Maybe we've sat down. And see if then let the bow lead your arm on a little bit of a dance. So I have to step back from my desk there. Let sort of focus on that on the tip that's leading the whole thing. You could make circles over here. You can make circles over here. Make circles up over your head. I can't quite even reach the ceiling with my bow. It's a high ceiling. Take the opportunity to like see how far your shoulder can open up. And bend your knees. Let's get like a little bit of flexibility into knees and waist. How's that? If anybody has a question so far, you could raise your physical hand, or you could raise your digital hand, or you could just unmute yourself and go ahead and ask it. Oh, okay. What do you think about bringing in the other part? I guess it's the third part of this equation, which is the vial itself. Maybe even before we sit down, just to kind of be in relationship with the vial as a physical object, right? It has weight. And it has balance, and it's quite fragile. So, in another way of saying that, it has feelings. It has a presence. And keep bending your knees and swaying your hips a little bit. So, by holding this considerable weight, if you can, you're not stiffening up your body. Or can you feel what? That like the path that the weight of that takes through your body to the floor. Now this is one that I do on my own all the time, but I'm not sure I've ever asked a class to do it before, so you're the privileged first. And we might now try, if you haven't already, just carefully step back to your chair. You need to know right where the chair is, obviously. So, how comfortable is that? I'm pretty comfortable. That feels good. I like to think of the weight on my feet and also the weight on my sit bones. So rocking just slightly back, feeling a bit more weight on the left, a bit more weight on the right, weight on the right. And lately I've been, what with aging and hips and things like that, I actually do that quite a lot while I'm playing in order to be sure I'm not stiffening up, because holding this thing is actually a fair amount of work. I used to, people say, how do you hold that thing without an end pin? I say, oh, it's no problem. It just sort of sits there. But I've become aware of the fact that you do hold it. And that if we're clinching harder than we have to, it can be kind of exhausting. And it also, tension in your hips pretty easily communicates itself to your shoulders. So let's now try like reaching forward with your left hand. And your shoulder blade follows, and you twist a bit, and then bring it back. And then reach forward with your tip of your bow, and so the right arm follows, and your shoulder blade follows. Okay. Might just try flying a little bit. You're always aware of this bow, so let's go back actually to paying attention to the bow and feeling its weight, and see if you can kind of actually get a feeling of the bow being an extension of your arm. That the weight of your bow, it's like another, you have your upper arm, you have your forearm, you have your hand, and then you have the another joint, and there's the bow. So that the whole thing can be working as a unit. And this is, the suspense is working up to the moment when we're going to use the sound, the bow, to make a sound. And my suggestion is to make it just absolutely most minimal, simple little beginning of the sound. So it's almost like, actually, you could take your left hand and just pluck the strings really gently. So you get the feeling of what those strings, the tension of them, and what they need in order to just start them vibrating. Then you're going to do that same plucking action, but with the bow. And you might want to start out at the tip, close to the tip, but you also might want to just experiment with all the strings and all the any different spots in the bow and different directions. So push or pull or tip or middle or frog and middle of the instrument. But the thing that you want to do is get the string ringing it just like a pluck. So you're going to release as soon as you never ever stop the bow on the string. And a lot of people feel like when they're off the string and getting back on, they're nervous about the bow doing a little bounce like that. And I'm just curious, if you're having that experience now, you might bring more attention to the fingertips that are on the hair. So that you can actually very actively use those fingertips to control the exact moment that you touch the string. And maybe just as a reminder, jiggle your weight back and forth between left and right so you're not suddenly tensing up your lower back just because you're trying to play. Maybe also just let the breath go in and the breath go out, very independently of what you're doing. And I've done this in a room of people where people got so engrossed in it that I just shut up and let them keep doing it for about 20 minutes. I was sort of curious to wait and see how long they would stay interested. And then it seemed like we go on all day, and I decided we better move on. But I want to just let you, it's different when you can hear everybody else doing it, maybe. But I'm going to take another moment and open up to comments or questions right now if anybody would like to speak up. I think you could probably just go ahead and unmute yourself and do that if you want to share or ask.
Do you have any thoughts on what's the best height of chair?
Ah, that's a very personal thing. I find it's best, I like a high enough chair so that my thighs are just slightly sloping downhill. You know, if it's high enough so that you have an absolute right angle, that would be the minimum. But if it's a little bit higher so that your thighs are sloping downhill, just a little bit. That's better. And I think it's again, for years I was just very nonchalant, thinking, well, you know, I'm not one of these picky people that has to have the certain height of chair. And now I'm getting pickier and pickier, and I just bought one to take with me wherever I go. So you can always experiment with cushions if your chair isn't high enough.
Thanks.
Sorry, Ibby, I've got a technical issue. I thought I was pressing unmute and I've just got a splodge on my screen and no sign of Sarah. Any hints?
No, we can hear you though.
I know, I can't see it.
If you can, well, maybe you should go ahead and speak anyway. You can switch screens by pressing the little triangle on the extreme left or the extreme right. But sometimes
Thank
it's
you.
great
I'll have
not
a fiddle with
to.
that. My question was going to be how engaged are your forefinger and your thumb when you're lifting the bow, or are you using your third finger to lift it?
I would say the forefinger and thumb are doing 35%, maybe.
Yeah.
They're present, they're active,
Okay.
but they're not super clenched. So, and I'm feeling more like the weight of the bow is resting on my ring finger.
On the ring finger, yeah.
That's
I
a really
still
good
can't
question.
find the triangle.
Yeah.
On that note, Sarah, can I ask, are you placing your right ring finger on the hair of the bow?
Yes, it's kind of underneath.
I see. Smashing. Thank you.
Yeah. It's hard to get exactly the right angle on Zoom to show you. And also, depending on gravity, it has a different effect if you're up or down. So, but that's basically the hold that I use. So that the middle finger is over the hair and the ring finger is under the hair if it's horizontal like that. And I've lately been noticing how many people do that with their wrist when they're playing, as if they think they need to do that to be on the flat of the hair. And that's actually a little bit dangerous for your arm. It's much more relaxing to just let your wrist hang, and it's better for the sound to be on the side of the hair, because then you're, with the amount of pressure, you're varying the amount of hair that actually goes onto the string, in contact with the string. So that's one of the factors in the sound, the volume and the nuance of the sound is how much hair is touching the string. So do not, my recommendation, do not hold your wrist up like that. Just let it hang.
I've got a question, Sarah.
Yeah.
Any tips on avoiding hitting the knee for the top string?
Oh boy. I've just, you know, it's just the last couple of years I've been having a nightmare with hitting my knee. So maybe I'm the right person to ask, or maybe I'm not. You know, and somebody just recently made a point to me that I'd never thought of, which is because we try and keep our bow straight, right, parallel to the bridge. And John Mark Rosendahl said to me, well, you know, it's not actually necessary for the bow to be perpendicular to the strings, as long as the motion is perpendicular to the strings. So I've now, because for some reason, I don't know if it's because I've gained weight or what, I can't seem to find a place to hold where I don't risk that pesky knee being in the way. And I'm having to let the tip go up if I'm near the frog on the top string. And that is not the end of the world, I suddenly realized. As long as the bow isn't following the tip up away from the bridge. So that may be a help. Obviously, the higher you can hold it, and the more vertically you can hold it, and of course, turning it towards the right, I always, so that your right leg is coming in front as the left leg is holding the back corner. So there's really quite a pronounced turning towards the right. Makes it, that's the first answer. The second answer is hold it as high as you can. And the third answer is if you still hit your knee, let the tip go up a little bit, but make sure that your point of contact is not going up as you come down the bow. Which is quite complicated geometrically, and I can't really do it by looking at it, but only by feel and by sound.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Any other questions? I'd sort of like to try before we do more with that plucking stroke. So that's just the very introduction to starting the sound. Let's do something, and before we bring the left hand into play at all, just some open strings in the middle of the instrument it's a triple rhythm. It's like minim, crotchet, minim, crotchet, half, quarter, half, quarter. So and this is emphasizing the strong weak, strong weak. We know that the push is the stronger and the pull is the weaker, but we want to really exaggerate that. And we have to doubly exaggerate it because of the bow speed. So the bow is going slower and faster. But on the pull, on the coming back bow, it's just going to be floating. You're just going to have a thread of sound. Whereas on the push, you're really going to sink in and you're going to feel the weight of your arm coming through your middle finger into the string. So you're like a hammock. But by the time you get down to the frog, you've released that so that you can just make a very floaty little turnaround without stopping the sound. Questions about that one, I'm going to add a couple of little elements of detail to that. And those are the bow change and the string crossing. What happens here? So to practice a bow change, try coming right down, maybe on the second string, on the A string or on the D string if you're playing tenor, and not right down to your hand, but pretty close. and see if you can bow, how far you can bow in both directions without actually moving your arm at all. So this is just opening your hand, closing it again. Or you can take off the bow off the string, and this is super valuable exercise. Starting the back bow or the pull stroke. Just by doing that, by closing your hand. And the analogy is like stroking a pussycat. So you're using the hair of the bow to stroke the string.
Sarah?
Yeah?
Can you move back a little so that we can see the bow hand? Thank you.
I can tip my screen more. It's such a... I should have a camera person here who could shift the focus. Because I was trying to get closer so that you could see that. And then... Now that, when you integrate that into the whole stroke, you don't want to do it too soon. So it's only at the end that you follow through. And then to start the coming back, the first movement is that. So it's your hand goes first and then your arm follows. So my belief is that works much better than starting first with the wrist. If you go back first with the wrist, then you're very likely to get a little bump. Whereas your hand, your fingers are the ones that can give a little floating moment to turn around without stopping the string in between. Because what we don't want to do is stop the resonance. The string goes on vibrating and we just manage to turn it. At the tip, the same thing happens, but much less. So there's just a little bit of cushioning from your fingers at the tip. Let's do just C major, one octave, couldn't be easier. And just to practice. Sit bone, your right sit bone, really comfortable on the chair, feet on the floor, your left hand, we haven't said anything about yet. If you put your fingers like on the third string, spreading them out, and then see if you can still like make nice relaxed little circles with your elbow so that everything through here is just as flexible as what we have over here. Your two hands talk to each other. That's something I just realized kind of recently, that like if you're with your left hand, if you're feeling just how much pressure it takes to push that string down, just what is that? It's not very much at all. It's the lightest touch actually takes it. But the information from that actually tells your bow, oh, that's how much tension there is on the string, which is relevant information for over here as well. And you can even feel the string vibrating in your fingertips of your left hand. And you can feel the string vibrating in the fingertips of your right hand. So it goes full circle, all the way around. And to me, this is just the magic of playing the viol, is that incredible close contact that we have with the string through both hands, of those wonderful organic gut strings and all of their roughness and gentleness. Can we now go back to the triple rhythm? One, two, three, one, two, three. I'll start over. We can do it together, even apart, together apart. One, two, three. I'm sure it's beautiful, but I'm going to move on as the hour is galloping away. I just promised you a minute ago something about string crossing, and the way to warm up on that is the simplest beautiful chord we have, an A minor chord on your bass or your treble, or it's a D minor chord on the tenor, is the same thing. So you just have your first finger on the first. And the secret of string crossings is that it's about the contact point, that you're just pivoting around the place where the bow touches the string, and all your arm has to do is follow. So there's nothing like that. There's no reaching around at all. And if you just put the bow on the string and do that, let it rock around that point. That's the way to get the feeling of that. And on this one, I combine that. It's just one smooth motion across all four strings. When I get to the top, I like to sustain it a little bit so that I can also practice my bow change there. As I get there, the hand opens up a little bit and then it begins coming back by closing. Same on the bottom. I let it sustain because the bass. A tiny bit more complicated for you. See if you can follow this. I'm going to do triplets going back and forth between each string. So that way we're alternating between the bow direction and the string crossing, because doing it on a pull is really quite different from doing it on a push. And you can. Keeping your elbow flexible at every instant. Your elbow never stops moving. And the only moving it's doing is like opening and closing like that. And it gives a kind of a snaky feeling. Thank you. I send around my exercises, there's a little chord progression, which is, I'm just going to show it to you now, and you might even, some of you might pick it up right away. But if you're used to playing chords at all, I got it from the Wentzinger book. It's the one thing that I've really taken from Wentzinger's method, but he got it from Christopher Simpson. And Christopher Simpson's exercises at the beginning of the book, he has a series of chords, and that's where this comes from. And it's A major, D minor, and then a little 4/3 suspension. And then you can also do it one string over. As I'm doing this, I'm noticing what's my back doing. Are my shoulder blades free to, your shoulder blades are kind of sliding a little bit over your rib cage? There's a little more to it than that, but that's the basic thing. And then various different rhythms, but I especially like
Sarah, can I just ask?
Sorry?
Could I ask about triplet rhythm that you were doing? Is separate bows? Could you
no, slurred. I'm slurring them in threes. Sorry, you can do them any way you want.
Would you just do that again, please?
Mm-hmm.
The A minor one.
The A minor one, sure.
Oh, thank you.
It's a slightly confusing motion for your arm till it gets used to it. To be very sympathetic to all these muscles and nerves that are actually combining in. Kind of complicated way. But all of that is going to pay just big dividends in being able to, like, know what string you're on, just cleanness of playing the right string, and also of getting across the instrument. Just jumping ahead again in the string crossing department. And this is one of the things that I'm hoping that you can develop through this approach, is like just building in a whole repertoire and range of expression and articulation into your bow technique. So if we try, you could do octaves, like octaves in G major or D major, C major, sorry, on the tenor. Let's do them plucky. It's not that they're super short, but they're just not sustained. And you can do any consonant that you like. You can go all the way from cha 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 to da da. Or even wah, wah. And I want to try one that's kind of in the middle, like maybe a pa, 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 pa. And you're doing that, you're starting the note by feeling the string and just giving it a little pluck. So you're feeling it here, where your fingers contact the hair. And that's the way you can feel exactly how you're plucking this. And the French call this stroke jeté, so thrown, but doesn't have to be as active as that sound. The main essence of it is a note has only a beginning, and then the release takes you immediately to where you want to be next. So the actual string crossing is attached to the note before. And you don't play this note until you know you're there. So let's do it nice and slow, G major. And we'll do each note twice, each octave twice, using all our open strings. let's start over. Let's see if we can do this together. Yeah. Oh, you're also good at stretching when you see me stretch. And make a little circle with your bow up there at the same time. Yeah. Okay, here we go. One, two, one, two. Relaxing your shoulders in between, or all the time. When you're off the string, you're relaxed. Beginning, I haven't even done yet, and so which is a wah 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 wah, which is I just keep like to go back and forth between those two elements, between the pa, the beginning of the stroke, and then the what you can do with this with the string when you're with the sound when you're on the note. So if we did like D major, and we'll just do I'll go easy on you, we'll just do two octaves. It's gonna let me just demonstrate. And it sometimes takes people a little while to get the hang of that. The key to it is that the motion of the bow is constant. So it just keeps floating along. In fact, maybe we should just try it on, like on one string. How airy of a sound can you make? So you're not pressing at all, just letting the bow move there. And then, without changing that motion, you're using this finger, to just dip in and out, to dip in. Squeeze, release, squeeze, release, while the bow keeps going. And this is the way you develop lots of things. Your awareness of the range of what that string can take. And you can then, so that you can shape your note in any way that you like when you're playing consort music or any kind of music. Let's try that going up just from there to there. We haven't, if you're having trouble getting to the bottom string, I don't think there's anything wrong with just moving the instrument slightly forward. You do not have to do a big Jordi Savall gesture, although you certainly can. Sorry. And then you also have an opportunity to practice your bow change. All of this is with the aim of bringing your attention and your awareness to these fingertips, which is where you can actually feel what is happening at the point of contact and what you're doing with the sound. So the pulling on and releasing is giving you the springiness of the string and the resistance of it, and also the grittiness of it. You might not want much grittiness, or sometimes you might. And then also then you have a chance to make bow change happen without stopping the resonance. See, you don't want to do, you never want to stop on the string. And you're just gonna start the next one by doing that with your hand. Here we go, that was enough introduction. One, two, three, four. My mind wandered off there. I didn't know if I was playing a 7-string or a 6-string. So that's the one I really recommend to start with, to start your practice session with. And I see that we're kind of right up to the hour of 3, and you're probably all getting hungry. Even though there's lots more that we could do. Can I show you one more? This is one I just invented for... working on Marais and having trouble with the little passé mordants, but I think it's a really good left hand coordination exercise. And we did a D minor, melodic minor, which could be G minor on the tenor. You have a little extension here. You're feeling the string, so you're not trying to bang really loud, you're just trying to do it no. No more effort than is actually needed. And you're keeping your fingers so that the extension goes like that, right? The extension is comes from just reaching back with your first finger, turning the hand a little bit. And in fact, if you're going from here at half position to wanting to extend, your thumb's going down with the second finger. You'll have to have me back to do more left-hand stuff if you like. Because I think we could just do that one. Let's just do that one and then we'll finish. A couple of questions, breakout rooms. Because we started a little bit late, after all. See natural lovely. Sounds beautiful.
Great. Thank you so much, Sarah. That's wow. A really helpful session. It's shortly we can go into breakout rooms, but before I click the button, does anybody have any questions to ask Sarah? And Sarah, by the way, I think it's a very good idea to maybe focus on the left hand another session if you if you're willing to do that. I think it's a really good thing to maybe next time look at the left hand.
You want to give us, Sarah, would you like to give us a hint about bow tensions? Bow tension.
Yeah. The basic rule of thumb is, I mean, obviously it's tapering a little bit, but you don't want it to be too bowed out and you don't want it to be too slack. You want to have some sort of sufficient feeling like a parallel thing there. I often take students' bows and tighten them up a little bit more. I think many people don't tighten their bows quite enough, but that's not to say you want to have it, arched like as if you were about to shoot an arrow or something. Anybody else?
Sarah, thank you very much. That was terrific. But do you have any advice about right hand thumb relaxation? I often find that my right hand thumb is getting stiff.
Oh, that's very interesting. Yeah. I like to have it really on the end of my thumb and a little bit bent. So I don't know if that helps. It may be, I think there is a bit of tension there. It's a kind of a matter of degree. Is that what you do, John? I didn't spot you before. Yeah. Yeah. And it may be this in the context of the whole hand, being more flexible, your thumb would not get so locked into a certain position. So that as you open your hand, your thumb, is moving a bit more rather than, or you may simply just be pinching too hard with it.
Well, I noticed when you were playing that your first finger, you often take it right off the stick.
Right off the stick, yeah.
And I think if you're gripping the stick with that finger, then that's going to set up tension in the thumb as well, isn't it?
I think it is, yeah. It may be just there's too much going into that thumb, that stick part of the grip.
Yeah.
Which, as I say, it just needs to be firm enough to be, engaged and kind of give you it's like a pivot point to work against. It doesn't need to be any more than that. Yeah. Anybody else?
This is Karen in Cincinnati. I have a question. I was hoping kind of coming into the workshop that maybe you'd offer us some exercises for continuing to improve in our technique. Do you have anything like that, or would that be a whole other workshop?
No, I'd be delighted to send, I have it all written up and I will send it to Mary and she can send it, I think, around to all the, email it to all the participants.
Hey,
yeah,
thank you.
And there are a few things included in that that I didn't get to today. I have a way of doing a scale that's nothing but push bows and then you can go on to the next. More things about getting comfortable getting off the string, but I think they're pretty self-explanatory, and I'm more than happy to do more follow-up at some point. So yeah, I will send that, and if you like I can also send you my paste up of all the Simpson exercises, which you can work through. You don't necessarily have to do them all at once all the time, but you can work through them. And that's an amazing, great, progressive bow and left hand series of things.